Well, as Raymond said, South Australians are living in a pivotal time in our history and are urgently seeking the answer to the question being asked in all modern societies in this globalised world. How can we live a great life while sustaining a healthy economy? And in South Australia, the question might more accurately be posed this way. How can we achieve even greater levels of prosperity while sustaining our livability, which is the envy of the world? Together, we need to forge an answer to this question. The truth is, the truth I've had to come to accept, is that South Australians were unconvinced at the last state election that either major party had the right answer to that question. And the fact that over 400 of you are gathered here today suggests that you also want to know the answer to this question. I'm told this event was the quickest selling event in CEDA's 54-year history, and it's the largest ever lunch that's been gathered by CEDA here in South Australia. I'd like to express my sincere appreciation for the efforts of the Foundation partners and other South Australians who have taken the time to formulate the Shaping the Future of South Australia document. As I said in the foreword to the government's 2013 economic statement, South Australia has always worked best when we have strong government, strong business, backed up by a strong community. The time and effort that so many South Australian businesses, community leaders, academics, and public servants have put into this work is testament to that idea. Of course, this work has been prompted by the dramatic changes which are occurring in the South Australian economy. And at a time of significant change, it's natural that South Australians will look for direction, something that can provide them the basic framework where they can make the big decisions they need to make in their lives, decisions about their education, their job choices, their investments. And what we've heard from the Shaping the Future of South Australia exercise is that this needs to start with a vision for South Australia. A vision that is clear, concise, and meaningful. A vision that's understood, believed, and crucially followed. A vision that's authentic. A statement about where we want to be as a state and what our values are. And a vision that captures the underlying tone of confidence that this exercise revealed and supports a call to arms for all sections of our community, government, business, and academia. I can assure you that we've heeded this call. We've also heard that this needs to be supported by bold and decisive action, and I'm impressed by the range of very practical things which have been identified in the report, and even more so by the willingness expressed by the people that design these things to be part of making sure that they work. Now, the case for change is clear. The promised mining bonanza of Olympic Dam has not yet materialised. Our largest industry by value, manufacturing, is in decline, with our car industry disappearing and doubts being raised, even as late as today, about our defence sector. We'll not simply be able to replace one industry with another, one large employer with another. It will require an entirely new approach, one that builds on our diverse economy and capitalises on the opportunities offered to us by the rapidly growing markets on our doorstep. Now, the government took a clear policy to the election that government will play a lead role in the transformation of the South Australian economy. And we believe that government does have a role in coordinating and supporting the transformation through the provision of innovative, targeted support for the growing sectors in our economy. This progressive role for government increasingly represents mainstream economic thought. The President of the Business Council of Australia, in a major speech delivered on the 28th of July, said these things. Government has a key role in enabling business to grow and create wealth. She went on to say, it must be part of a strategic agenda that facilitates, enables, and incentivises key sectors where Australia can succeed globally. And she went on to call for governments to take a more sophisticated view of structural reform. So we've been asked to lead, and we accept that responsibility. However, governments cannot do this alone, and I'm incredibly heartened by the collaborative spirit that's been epitomised by the Shaping the Future of South Australia program, a philosophy which is deep in our DNA, as was noted by the Governor earlier. But we haven't been waiting. Since the election, we've been taking action. We've set about renewing our government. We've renewed our cabinet with five new cabinet ministers. We've renewed our public service with five new chief executives. And we've renewed our structures. A new department singularly focused on the key economic drivers that will help create our transition from old industries to industries that add value. We believe in a manufacturing future, but it will be a value-added future. The Department for State Development will help us with all of this. And we've challenged government boards and committees to demonstrate what value they provide to the community. We've told them if they can't do this, we'll find new ways to serve and listen to our community. And we've set up a new Economic Development Cabinet Committee, linked by common membership with non-cabinet ministers to the Economic Development Board, to drive forward our economic agenda with a focus on execution and accountability, a key theme that runs through all that's been told to us. Now we take the next step. Today, we announce a new vision for South Australia. It draws upon our new brand for South Australia. Now the brand, as many of you would be aware, was itself the product of an extensive process of engagement that drew upon the input of thousands of South Australians from across the state. It reflects what we hold to be true about ourselves, and it reflects our ambitions for our future. What emerged was a bold new icon that represents an open door to the world. We're open to new people. We're open to new ideas. We're open to investment and business partnerships. We're open to new markets. We are open to the world. But how can we capture that in a vision statement? Fueled by the Shaping the Future process, and the dialogue many of us have had about our vision for this great state is South Australia, the place where people and business thrive. South Australia is already a great place to live, and we value that as a community. This vision is about protecting that way of life that we value so highly, but opening the door to new ideas, new opportunities, new people, and new businesses. It's about finally shaking off the perception of Adelaide being a place that's staid or boring or conservative. It's about us taking bold actions and seizing opportunities. It's acknowledging that we must try new things, even though some of them might not go to plan. But a vision without a plan is just hollow rhetoric. So we've identified 10 economic priority areas that will ensure that South Australia is well placed to thrive in this modern global context. These 10 priorities, five of which highlight five key sectors of focus, the second five, priorities that enable and facilitate economic development, are set out now. Priority one, our resources, energy and renewable assets. Priority two, our premium food and wine. Priority three, a global leader in health, research and ageing. Priority four, the knowledge state, and priority five, a destination of choice for both our education and tourist services. So those first five priorities are essentially the sectors. The second five priorities are the enablers of growth. Priority six, growth through innovation. Priority seven, the best place to do business. Priority eight, Adelaide, the heart of our vibrant state. Priority 9, our international connections, and priority 10, small business access to capital and global markets. I'll go into a little more depth in relation to these 10 priorities. What I won't do today is describe the key outcomes we want to achieve over the next 3 years for each of these priorities. I want to be able to incorporate your thinking to build on the work in the Shaping the Future program and get input from businesses, public service, and the wider community. Rest assured, I know that priorities without specific executable deliverables are hollow, and it's the responsibility of the Economic Development Committee of Cabinet to ensure that we are tracking well over the next 3 years towards our stated objectives. And at the end of the session, you'll receive a handout documenting the vision and the priorities, And you'll see on the screen behind you that the relevant paragraphs as I summarise the priority and give you an example or two. So priority one, unlocking the full potential of South Australia's resources, energy and renewable assets. This has been an area of real strength for this state. We're consistently recognised as having one of the finest mines departments anywhere in the world. This regulatory capacity has driven an enormous set of opportunities for us. In 2004, we established the PACE initiative to bring forward discovery of new mining and energy resources to ensure South Australia has a pipeline of world-class mineral and energy developments into the future. And while we continue to open new mines in the state, we also leverage the activity generated by mining and energy into intellectual property. So the solutions to the problems of unlocking the resources we have here provide themselves fantastic economic opportunities, global business opportunities for local mining services companies. The establishment of the Mining Industry Participation Office will help South Australian manufacturing companies to participate in the benefits of this expanding mineral and energy resources sector. And this has been an area of the economy which has changed significantly in just the last couple of years. We've seen with companies like Beach Energy, who are now engaged in successful environmentally sustainable oil production and production operations that are already underway generating jobs. Many of you won't be aware, but Beach Energy's hired an additional 50 people over the past year and has recently announced their intention to hire another 70. And Beach, together with US giant Chevron, are engaged in large-scale gas, unconventional gas reservoirs in the Cooper Basin. Priority two. Premium food and wine produced in our clean environment exported to the world. Since our founding, agriculture has provided many examples of innovation. Today, we're focusing on innovations in production and processing in order to meet the growing world demand for high-quality food and wine. We can never become Asia's food bowl, but by maximising the production of value-added and differentiated food, we can become Asia's specialty delicatessen and sell very profitable premium products to our northern neighbours. And it's happening already. A business called Sundrop Farms, a company that produces tomatoes, cucumbers and capsicums using solar thermal desalination technologies, is in operation as we speak just outside of Port Augusta. We've been working closely with them. We helped them with their pilot project. They're now engaged in an extension project which will provide 60 to 80 jobs in the expansion phase and 200 production jobs ongoing in that important area of South Australia. Priority three, a globally recognised leader in health research, ageing and related services and products. We've invested heavily in providing world-class clinical and research facilities in our biomedical precinct, which will be one of the largest health precincts in the Southern Hemisphere. And it's the most physically apparent change that's occurred to South Australia as you come up to our beautiful capital city. As a result, we're well placed to optimise the research, teaching, training and clinical services and accelerate the development and delivery of world-class healthcare and ageing products and services. This will not only provide better healthcare for South Australians, it will also lead to the development of new industries and position us as a leader in a growing Asian market. This is an incredibly exciting area of endeavour for us as a state. And our international reputation in this area is growing. South Australia's strength in leukaemia research is both the best in the nation and is of international significance. The leukaemia research in this state has led to new diagnostics and treatments that have profoundly improved the survival rate of this frightening disease for children and adults. These developments in diagnostics and management have reduced the toxicity of treatment and increased the likelihood of successful treatment and remission. Through the development of SAMRI, the South Australian Health and Medical Research Institute, and the wider medical precinct, we not only have recruited the best and brightest research minds from around the nation, we've also retained crucial areas of expertise here that would otherwise have left our shores. Priority four, the knowledge state. Attracting a diverse student body and commercialising our research. Collaboration and co-investment between global and local industry in our research institutions will drive the development of South Australia as a place of knowledge, creation and innovation. You only need to think of the thriving economies of the world, whether it be Germany, Scandinavia, or those parts of the US that are actually resurgent. Ohio, North Carolina, Pittsburgh. One of the common aspects of those burgeoning economies is that they've found a way to structurally link universities and business together to ensure the concepts that come out of universities can find a home in business and that the needs of business can be addressed by universities. Now, we've seen that here in South Australia. Tonsley Park and its link with business in Flinders is a fantastic example. We've got to improve the commercialisation processes of the great thinking, research and discoveries that are happening in our universities. Our universities need to be at the front line of economic development because our future as a state is as a knowledge economy. That's what's going to differentiate us from other places. Priority five, South Australia, a growing destination of choice for international and domestic travellers. Our tourism sector is an incredibly important one. 30,000 people across all parts of the state and an economic benefit of about $5.2 billion. We've announced our new tourism plan, which has an ambition to build that to $8 billion by 2020. And the opportunities presented by that burgeoning Asian middle class seeking better travel experiences are significant. And we have a world-class offering. I think we don't necessarily understand what we have and so sought after it is in the world. The natural wonders of KI, that beautiful and extraordinary coast off Port Lincoln, and of course our great wine regions and all of the food and wine experiences associated with them. This is world class. If we build a culture of service excellence in all of our tourism offering, we can make visitors return here and enthusiastically recommend it to others. What would it be to say that we've actually unlocked the question of service excellence? There's a measurably different level of service you get here than any other place in the nation. I want all South Australians to be vocal about our state, what it has to offer, and be part of ensuring that people who experience it have a fantastic time. So these are the five sectors that we're focusing on. Five sectors we've deliberately chosen because we believe they have the capacity to grow the fastest over the next period of time. Now to the five priorities that will enable businesses and the community to thrive. The first of those, growth through innovation. The transformation of the South Australian economy will be built on our ability to adopt new ways of doing things and use advanced technologies to build globally competitive high-value firms. We need businesses that can integrate with and provide significant value add to the global supply chain. We've got to interrogate everything we do to ask ourselves whether we can do it in a better way. Innovation does drive growth, sustainability and the diversification of our businesses and, of course, the broader economy. Now, we've got some successful automotive businesses that are already exploring new product innovations beyond their current roles, applying what they know well to new sectors, not paralysed in the face of the closure of Holden's, but innovating, finding new ways of actually insinuating themselves into global supply chains. Our governments have a clear role to play in supporting access to information, skills and connections so that companies can experiment with business innovation and collaborate with the research community more effectively. This is a crucial enabler, those connections, the things that Con talked about, who you know, putting people in touch with the right skills, the right capacity, matching it up with capital. To give you an example, this isn't a dream, it's already happening. Airspeed is a South Australian company that's produced a lightweight composite that can be used in place of steel casing. A structure made of a composite weighs as little as 38% of the previously used structure. The composite is now being used in the Collins-class submarine. The product helps improve the performance of the sub and also adds to Australia's naval defence capability. Airspeed is based in Mawson Lakes and have benefited from our efforts to provide infrastructure of critical mass so that they can work together with smaller businesses and opportunity to thrive. The work of Airspeed is an example of the innovative output of government and the endeavour to reproduce it, not just in the defence sector, but across the whole of our economy. The seventh priority, South Australia, the best place to do business. making South Australia the place that business thrives means that we have to do a number of new things. Commit ourselves to fixing the unnecessary barriers to business growth that get in the way. Speed up approval processes in our planning and development systems. Ensure that our regulations promote innovation rather than create burdens. And finally, ensuring that all government agencies have a strong customer service ethos. We're already acting in this area. From discussions with business leaders, it's evident that there are three main blockages in the planning and approval system: state referral agencies, local government development assessment panels, and policy blockages. James Hallion, the Chief Executive of Premier and Cabinet, has now been appointed to a Coordinator General role. That's to help stimulate private sector investment for projects with a construction value in excess of $3 million. James has only been in the role for 6 weeks and has held detailed discussions with companies that have identified over 100 projects with a total value of about $1 billion now invested or ready to invest in our state. A case manager has been assigned to each of those organisations, and already a number of projects that have been stalled in the past have now been unblocked or at least now have a certain path through to approval. These projects will provide in excess of 3,500 construction jobs and thousands of ongoing permanent jobs. I want to stress this new process isn't about getting a bad project up through a shortcut. It's about making sure that we facilitate quality projects in the right locations assessed against rigorous policy and legislative processes. However, I will not tolerate bureaucrats and councils hiding behind prescriptive and often outdated policies. I'm insisting that a culture needs to exist where we find innovative and collaborative solutions that get projects off the ground and help the economy and jobs. It's not an answer to say we've run up against this barrier. The obligation is to find a way around it, a bias for yes. Go to the key decision maker that's created the rule, that's created the barrier, and ask them to change it. The blockages identified by the Coordinator General that are actually a result of these outdated policies will inform the work of another structure we've set up, the Simpler Regulation Unit. And I'm asking business and citizens that encounter these outdated policies to come forward with your proposals to improve the regulatory process. I'm convinced that we can preserve the thing that we're seeking to protect, whether it be a safety standard or whether it be some environment protection, but at the same time ensure that we get rid of unnecessary burdens in the regulation. Development of simpler regulation will be most successful if it's led by the people that actually have to participate in it. I'm convinced that if those people, in good faith, sharing the same objective to protect the relevant public policy interest that is being protected, are prepared to come up with a better way of doing it, we might not get lowest common denominator outcomes, we might actually get best practice and improve the regulatory outcome for all concerned. This is my challenge, and we want a leadership role from everybody in this room. Priority 8, Adelaide, the heart of the vibrant state. Adelaide, as our capital city, represents to the world who we are and serves as a gateway to the whole of our state. We've made the transformation of Adelaide a key element in our agenda. The redeveloped Adelaide Oval, the growth of the universities, the activation of our city laneways through the small bar legislation has opened our city to new opportunities. And this, along with our health and industrial precinct, and the upgrade of the Adelaide Convention Centre, means that a new group of people will be attracted to our state. But what we need to provide is more opportunities for young entrepreneurs to give them a real opportunity to develop their business in South Australia. We don't want people moving interstate or overseas saying, I can't get a start here. We want this place to project the values which say, if you've got an idea here, it can work here. And we're going to give you every opportunity to get your business off the ground. We've seen a number of new business hubs opening around the city, and these are providing young people a cost-effective environment in which to work. We want these to unlock the drive and enthusiasm of our young entrepreneurs. Priority 9, promoting South Australia's international connections and engagement. South Australia's prosperity depends on our international connections, engagements, and alliances. Every business has to regard itself as a global business. Businesses that are integrated into national and international economies have the greatest opportunity for growth, and they create the best jobs. More secure jobs, better paying jobs, more interesting jobs. So there's every reason we need to connect internationally. Capital that co-invests with local businesses, helping them to expand and access new markets, is the model we must pursue. It's the only way we have ever developed as a state. To succeed, we must also welcome new migrants and value their ideas, entrepreneurship, cultural connections and capital that they bring to our state. We have a proud history of multiculturalism, with about 350,000 people now living here who were born overseas. These are natural ambassadors that have natural connections to the world. Many of our migrants have made significant contributions to the development of our state and contributed to the lifestyle and opportunities and have created our sense of identity. Our migrant connections make international opportunities available to us. Now, South Australia already benefits from the extraordinary network of leaders throughout our region because we first opened our doors up to them to international students several decades ago. I recently had the honour of meeting the President of Singapore, Dr. Tony Tan Keng Yam, an alumni of the University of Adelaide, where he obtained his PhD in applied mathematics. I spoke to Dr. Tan about getting together with the Singaporean Economic Development Board and South Australia's Economic Development Board, and we hope to achieve that later this year. If the leader of an advanced economy like Singapore is favourably disposed to doing business with South Australia because of the strong personal connections between its leader and our state, then this is a relationship model that we have to invest in and grow further. Priority 10. South Australia's small businesses having access to capital and global markets. As we all know, small and medium-sized enterprises are the foundation for South Australia's economy and the driving force behind employment and growth. We're promoting the development of ecosystems which support all aspects of business development, particularly companies with high growth potential. And to support the ongoing growth and resilience of the state economy, South Australian businesses require access to capital, skills and connections in order to become global businesses. So I'm pleased to announce today a major new initiative which responds to a key business demand. To address the question of accessing capital and accelerating industry growth in this state, the South Australian Government will join forces with the banks to develop a new Unlocking Capital for Jobs program. As a first step in this policy, the government will offer financial guarantees to the value of $50 million. This offer will allow up to $250 million to be leveraged in funding to secure and accelerate new job creation here in South Australia over the next 4 years. Over the next month, the Deputy Chair of the Economic Development Board, Rob Chapman, will work with the banks and relevant government departments to formulate a process that will best service the objectives of the program. Broadly, it will work through the state government offering to secure commercially viable loans where companies would otherwise not have the balance sheet strength to access finance. This is a concept based on successful programs in the United Kingdom, New Zealand, and Canada. This program will not only be a great win for South Australia, but also shows that the government working in conjunction with local companies can look beyond traditional funding models and deliver a solution that is both innovative and creative. It's not something that will involve the government taking loan servicing risks that the banks would not. Businesses who secure finance through this program will still be required to have a viable business plan and significant skin in the game. All of the major banks have agreed to participate as part of the program, and I'd like to thank their willingness and commitment to cooperate with the state government in the development of this exciting initiative. I'd also like to thank the Economic Development Board for their leadership role in ensuring this concept could be delivered. Ladies and gentlemen, we will only realise the potential of this vision and each of these economic priorities if we work together. South Australia has always worked at its best when we've done this. Government, working alongside business, but bringing the community along with us. The economic vision that we've announced today constitutes a new approach to governing in South Australia, a new form of leadership, collective leadership. All that's been put before you today has emerged from a form of leadership that is, could be described as bringing together the South Australian community, and the product is better for it. My expectation for the business community is that you will continue to find ways to move your products and services up the value chain. I expect you to be bold in seeking out new markets for what you make or do. I expect that you will stay engaged in the change process. And I expect that you'll bring to government new ideas and approaches that will lead to simpler regulation and a more competitive business environment. And if you do these things, you will have the support of the government. My expectations for the academic community is that you will extend your university's research strengths, that you will add increased focus to commercialisation, that you will provide a distinctly attractive academic environment for students, and in all these matters, you will have a strong government partner. And my expectation of the public service is that you will lift the standard of professionalism across the entire public service, that you will develop innovative and simpler regulation, and adopt a can-do attitude with a clear focus on customer outcomes. And once again, this will be led by my government. But to achieve all of this, there is one additional element without which none of this is possible: self-belief. From this moment, I'm asking all South Australians to project a quiet confidence about their future, a steely resolve about the changes that need to be made today so that South Australia will have its place in the world, a place where people and business thrive. Today, ladies and gentlemen, you've heard about our vision for the future. We'll continue to pursue each of these 10 priorities with a series of bold, measurable objectives that we will publish, and I'll invite you to contribute to their successful implementation. But we will hold ourselves to account in relation to them. I acknowledge today that we won't win every contest, but we will stick to the plan. We'll be focused and disciplined in the execution of these objectives. As Nelson once remarked, the boldest measures are the safest. For South Australia, we no longer have the choice. We must be bold. We must ensure that we take the steps necessary to transform our economy. Ours is a great state, one of the most extraordinary and most beautiful places anywhere in the world to live. We have the potential to unlock the secret of this era: how to achieve a shared prosperity in a globalised age while enhancing our quality of life and job security. I want you to join with me as we go on this exciting journey together. Thank you.